Well, hello, y'all. It is Transformation Tuesday again, and today we're going to be talking with my friend Elizabeth, and she's going to be telling us all about her transformation story, what Christ did for her. And I want to say at the very beginning of this video that they are all in my photos. Let me add Sister Elizabeth. All you have to do is go into my photos, approve.
Well, she beat me to it. There we go. So this is Transformation Tuesday. It's all about salvation experiences, what God has done and what he continues to do, because connecting.
Yay, there she is, because he is that kind of a God. If you want to watch, we have been doing a Transformation Tuesday ever since, I think it was the week after Christmas. Or the week before Christmas. I don't remember, but there's been one every week since then. So if you want to go back and watch them, all you have to do is go to my photos and in my videos, and they're all right there. And they are also uploaded onto YouTube now. So you can, all you have to do is put in capital T 2019, and it will bring them up on Facebook. So this is my friend Elizabeth, and we're going to be talking to her. And she's going to be telling us her transformation story. So, Sister Elizabeth, just wherever you feel to start, you just go ahead and start.
Okay. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, ma'am. I hear you just fine.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure. My testimony is I wasn't raised in church. I didn't know anything about church or anything, I had a little exposure, and I was told that my grandpa was actually a Baptist preacher, and I do remember him preaching a little bit, but I was probably only, maybe 3-4 years old. But as far as exposure, I never had any exposure, to church. So one day I was sitting in my friend's kitchen. We had just graduated high school, so I was probably 18 years old, and she began to tell me about how her and her husband got saved. And I said, saved? What are you talking about? What is saved? I didn't even know what that word meant. Uh-huh. And she began to tell me their story of how they got saved. And I said, you mean you have to be saved to go to heaven? And she said, yes, you have to be saved to go to heaven. And I remember a great fear rose up within me. And I actually got afraid. Because I thought good people went to heaven and bad people went to hell. That's what I thought. My mom did the best she could. She raised us with morals and manners and things like that. But I thought good people went to heaven and bad people went to hell.
Right.
And so I remember talking to my friend and I said, I'm to everybody I know and knew. And ask them, are you saved? Mm-hmm. How did you get saved? And then I got confused because everybody's story was different. Nobody's was the same.
Right.
But that confused me even more because I wanted to do the same thing they did to get saved, but I didn't really know what to do. And I look back now and I know that was the process of God dealing with me. He had started to deal with me. And so it took me about a year. But I went around and I read things and I started reading in the Bible. And where did I start reading? In the book of Revelation.
Oh my goodness.
I didn't know what I was doing, but kind of that's where I started at. And I was totally confused, but ended up going to this little Baptist church in Oklahoma where I lived with my mom and talked to the pastor there a little bit about wanting to be saved. And we said the sinner's prayer, but I didn't feel settled in here. Mm-hmm. I still felt incomplete. And I remember we went to this revival service one time out in Oklahoma. And looking back now, I know it was a Pentecostal preacher, but I didn't know that at the time. He was just full of fire and he was full of life. That's what I thought. And I thought, man, I'm hungry for that. Mm-hmm. And I remember even telling our pastor that I was with, I said, I really feel like I need to go up there and pray and get saved. And he said, oh, no, 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 no. You're saved already.
Oh, wow.
He said, you're just feeling like the emotion or whatever. And I told my mom, I said, Mom, I'm not just feeling emotion. I'm feeling to truly go up and pray and ask the Lord to save my soul. And, you know, looking back now, I know that was that was God's conviction, mm-hmm. you know, and he was calling me. And we ended up moving away from Oklahoma just a few months after that. And we came over to this area in Kentucky and started going to Glenn Hyden's church, who's my father-in-law now. But at that service, I felt that same feeling again. And I said, I'm going to pray this time. I'm not asking anybody. I'm just going to go pray. And I did. And the rest is history, as they say. But the Lord saved me that night. And I felt complete then. I felt like I got what I was looking for, you know, what I was searching for. People say, well, the Lord searches you out. Well, I felt like I was searching him out. But at the same time, he was looking for right. me. He came looking for me. And I thought I was looking for him this whole time.
Amen.
But he was looking for me that whole time. And God saved me. And I'm so grateful that he saved me. And that fear of going to hell was gone
right.
after that. I wasn't afraid of it anymore.
Now tell me again how you wind up at your father-in-law's church.
So my family's kind of spread out between California, Texas, Kentucky. And then my stepdad's family, they're from Oklahoma because he's a Native American Indian. So we lived there for just a little bit. But then they decided they wanted to move to Kentucky to be around family and different mm-hmm. things. Well, I don't think my dad liked that too much. Didn't work out too much, yeah. but he didn't really like it up here. So they kind of settled down in Alabama. But I stayed here because I met Dave and we got married. So I stayed here. But that's how we came to this area. We have family here.
Wow. Amen. So how many years ago has it been? You were.
So by the time all this happened, I was 21 years old when I got saved. And I'm fixing to be 46.
Hey, I just turned 50 this year. So it's all good.
That many years ago. And it's been the best years of my life. I say all the time, I wish I knew about this when I was in high school. I could go back and do things differently, but we can't.
Right.
I've learned, you know, we've learned from it. That's what gave me experiences and, you know, but it is what it is. But God saved me when he did, and he was just in time. So
amen.
I'm grateful
amen.
For that.
So you got saved young. I got saved young, but I backslid for a little while. And I got saved when I was 20, and then I backslid when I was 33. And I was backslid for 2 years, and then I came back to the Lord. But you've never backslid.
No, I can, you know, it's not been perfect. Sometimes the walk's been a little difficult. You know, yeah. You go through things, and nobody ever said being saved was going to be a bed of roses or tiptoeing through the tulips, like they say. We have trials and we have tribulations, and I've been in some real whoppers of a tribulation, you know, but the Lord has always brought me out.
Amen.
And nothing is ever to me worth going back to. There's nothing back in my life before I got saved that could ever compete with what the Lord has to offer.
Amen.
And there's nothing for me to go back to. And I know people do, you know, people make mistakes, but that's what's so good about God's mercy and God's love is it's like the prodigal child, you know, he went away and spent all his money and he wasted it on riotous living and partying and doing the things we do day to day, you know, what people do. He made a mistake. But his father was there with open arms. And that's how God is to us. He loves us so much that, you know, no matter what we do, if we'll get up and say, Lord, I'm sorry.
Right.
He's right there waiting. That mercy and that love and that grace.
Amen.
Is just, you know, nothing to go back to and nothing can ever beat that or top that.
That's right. That's right. With me, I had lost my hope. I had lost my joy. I thought, you know, things are always going to be the way they are. And I don't want to live the rest of my life like this. I was miserable.
Yeah.
And so in my mind, I had truly lost all hope. So I backslid. And then I found out that's when you truly have no hope at all. And then I felt condemnation. And so I stayed out longer than I wanted to because I felt condemned. And then I wound up getting hooked on drugs again. And, you know, because a dog will go back to its vomit. It will. You know, just saying, if you've been delivered from something and you backslide, you're going to go right back to it eventually. And it'll be worse.
The word says you'll get seven times worse. Yeah.
Amen.
So,
amen.
That's a fearful thing to me. I don't want to go back.
That is no longer my vocabulary. I get upset. Yeah. I feel hopeless at times, but I know outside of Christ, there truly is no hope. And what really finally came to my mind was the fact, okay, I'm backslidden and I have no hope. If I go back to God, I might feel like I don't have any hope, but I do have hope.
Right.
You know, we don't walk by feelings. You know, we walk by faith.
No. That's right. We have to walk by faith.
So circumstances had not changed at all. None. Everything was still exactly the same. Well, except worse. It was worse than what it had been.
It usually gets worse.
It was a lot worse than what it had been. But God worked everything out. You know, he's a true and a living God. And, you know, you're in the ministry now, correct?
Yes. Yes, I am. With my husband. Yes, we are.
Yes. Yes. And I think that's awesome because you got saved at 21, right? 21?
21 years old.
21.
Yeah.
He kept you all these years. Yeah. And not only did he save you, but he gave you a purpose.
Yes, he did. And I look back and I think, you know, God, he's always had a calling on my life and I didn't even know it, you know, but that's how a lot of us are. You know, there's a lot of us that have callings on our life or we have gifts or we have a purpose. We all have a purpose. I don't care who you are. You can be just a lay member. You don't have to play an instrument. You don't have to be a preacher, minister, teacher, anything. You still have a purpose in this life.
Amen.
And even if you just going around telling people your testimony, that's a purpose because we're called to bring people to the kingdom of God. That's what this life is all about. I was thinking about that today. You know, I thought there's people that have millions of dollars in the bank and they're out here wondering what car they're going to buy next, you know, but our purpose is to share the gospel with people to give them hope. Like you were talking about, you didn't have any hope. Here I was a girl who lives, you know, in the United States of America, and I didn't even know you had to be saved. So there's people that need to hear the gospel, even in the United States. It's good to have missionaries outside, but we need people in the United States just giving your testimony.
Amen. Hey, I'm so glad you brought that up because so many people think, well, I've got to go to another country or this or that. And we have a mission field right in our backyard because our minds, our minds tell us everybody in the United States knows all about Jesus, but that's not true.
That's right. That's
about
right.
10 years.
They don't. I didn't.
Right. About 10 years ago. No, it's been longer than that now. Oh, my goodness. I guess probably 20 years ago, a person that I had known for several years at that time, he was 42 and he didn't know anything about Christ. Nothing at 42 years old.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, we have a mission field right in our backyards. All we have to do is look.
Absolutely. That's right. There's many people walking around like that, believe it or not. You know, we always think, well, everybody knows about the Lord. No, they don't.
That's right.
They really don't.
That's right.
Yeah.
We just, our mind says because there's so many churches, but people.
But they don't
know. They don't know.
Yeah.
They might know.
Or they're, they know of something, or they may think about heaven, or they may think there's a heaven, but there's no hell.
Right.
Or they might be exposed even to a religion that's a false religion.
That's right.
So growing up, I forgot to tell that part, but when I was 12 years old, we were exposed to the Mormon church. And that was probably the only church I was ever exposed to. And I took the classes with the missionary. I got baptized. But not too long after that, my mother started asking some questions to the bishop of the church, you know, about the religion and about the faith and just kind of getting more into it. And he politely told her, you're not allowed to ask these questions. Well, my mother said, if I can't ask you questions about this faith and about the religion, I can't live this faith. So she pulled us out. But that was probably the only exposure I had to church right there. But
wow.
So there's so many people who are exposed to a false religion. And what they believe is really not the right thing. You know, they're just deceived and they don't really know. They just believe what they've been taught, mm-hmm. I guess, is what I'm trying to say.
Amen. That's right. So, and
yeah.
And everybody is looking for the truth.
Yeah.
And
I was.
And we have the truth, not a watered down truth, not a fake truth, but the truth, something that's real. Right. And that's what we got. We got what's real.
And that's right. And that's exactly what I was looking for. I thought, you know, when she told me about being saved, and I spent that entire year searching. I just began searching and, you know, asking people, everybody I knew. They probably got tired mm-hmm. of hearing me say, "Are you saved? Are you saved? How'd you get saved?" But I wanted to know, you know, I wanted to know.
That's awesome. I think it's a great testimony. Yeah. My goodness. I think that's awesome.
Yes.
Because when you thought you were searching, he was searching. He came looking for you.
Absolutely. Yep. I thought I was looking for him, but he was really looking for me.
And
I tell people that all the time.
Right, right. And he was protecting you.
Yes. Oh, Sister Judy, I look back on my life as a teenager, and I was a drinker. I drank, I partied. I didn't do drugs. I did smoke marijuana a couple of times, but that was never for me. But my thing was drinking. I like to drink. And there was one night that I remember that I drank so much that I passed out in my sleep, you know, and I was at home, but I thought I was waking up in the middle of the night, throwing up in my sleep. And my sister kept trying to keep me awake and she couldn't keep me awake. And I thought I could have very, very easily have just slipped out that night. But God, he knew what I would be one day.
Amen.
And he kept his hand on me and said, you know what? One day she's going to be a minister for me. One
Amen.
Day she's going to tell people how she got saved and how I touched her and how I delivered her and how I helped her. And that's what I do. I go around telling people what God has done for me. He's done so much for me. I can't tell it
Amen.
All, but I try to.
Amen. Amen. Now, I mean, no disrespect when I say this. So anybody that's out there in Facebook land, I have Native American Indian in me also. And I also know that that is a stronghold to a lot of Native American people is alcohol.
It is. They're alcoholics.
Yes.
The majority.
Yes.
Yes.
And
yes,
that leads into drugs. And, you know, I
yes.
started the opposite way. I started with the drugs and then I drank a little bit. But there's
yeah.
there's certain things that seem to attach themselves. And if we are not careful,
yes.
we will slide right into that same pattern.
Absolutely.
But with Christ,
yeah.
you know, all things are possible. That's what's on my shirt.
All
I can do all
That's
things
right.
through Christ, which strengthens me. Yes.
Yes. Amen.
So,
That's right.
He protected you. You thought you was looking for him and he found you. You got saved at
Absolutely.
21 and he's kept you
yeah.
all these years. And now you're a mouthpiece for him. And
That's
got
right.
a beautiful family.
He kept me when I couldn't keep myself. Yes. The Lord's truly blessed us. You know, again, that's a great testimony. The doctors told me I'd never have children. I went through all the testing and the testing came back that I couldn't. It was not possible for me physically to have children. I wasn't doing the things a woman should do in order to make that happen. But I had a lady come by the church and she told me, God said, you're going to have a child. And I wrote that down in my Bible because I take that as a promise
Amen.
From God.
Right.
I take that as a promise. I put the date, wrote it down. And about a year later, I got pregnant with Josh. And the doctor said, what happened? I said, it was all God.
Amen.
Because that's all she could say is, what happened?
That's it.
I said, the Lord did it.
Amen.
But he gave us Joshua. And I'm thankful for
yeah.
that. He's been so good to me, Sister Judy. I just love him.
Amen. Yes, he has been. And when the devil tried to take Josh out this past year, God said, uh-uh, I'm
yeah.
not done.
No, no, no. You can't touch God's anointed.
That's
you
right.
You can't, you know, God will only allow the devil to go so far, and then he says, okay, you're done. I'm stepping in right now. And he did that with Josh and healed him.
Amen.
And, you know, it's just been so wonderful. The Lord is so good.
Amen. Well, sister, I thank you very much for sharing. I thank you for your testimony. I thank you for your obedience to Christ. You know, I truly am blessed to have gotten to know you and your husband and your in-laws. And, you know, I'm just truly blessed to have you all as a part of my life. And I truly mean that from the bottom of my heart.
We are as well, sis. Yeah. We are as well.
So I thank you for coming on our Transformation Tuesdays. And next week, her husband is going to share his Transformation Tuesday, and he is a PK kid.
Yes, he is. So you don't want to miss his testimony. Yeah. He's got – his is a little bit more interesting than mine, you know, but, or juicy, I should say.
Well,
you know, I guess if that's a word you want to use, but – He's got a great testimony. He really does. The Lord put us together, and he's got a wonderful testimony.
Amen. So do you, sister. A lot more than you realize.
Yeah. Any testimony, anybody that's saved has a good testimony. Even if you got saved at a young age and you've never done anything bad in your
life.
That's
the best.
Just the fact that Jesus saved you, that's a great testimony.
I think that's the best testimony, because that's the keeping power
absolutely.
Of God.
Absolutely. Yes, which is important.
Yes, very important. The testimony I have is a testimony of deliverance, but I honestly believe with all my heart, the testimony of someone that has always allowed the Lord to lead them and has always allowed the Lord's protection over them, I think that is a much greater testimony than what I have.
Yes,
I truly do.
Right.
I truly do. Well, I thank you, Sister Elizabeth, and you
All
have
right,
a great night. And for those that are watching, her son, Josh, he gave his testimony 3 weeks ago, I think it was. And now his mom, this is Sister Elizabeth, she just gave hers. And Brother David Hyden will be giving his next week. He's a PK kid. So next we'll have to get the mother-in-law and the father-in-law on here.
Hey, they've got great testimonies too. So we could do that. We could make it happen.
Yes, well, let's make it happen. We'll just have a family gathering. That'd be awesome. It really would.
Hey, that's all right. Yeah.
All right. Well, you have a,
we'll
amen. You have a blessed night, sister.
Okay.
Thank you very, very much. I appreciate
you
it.
You too. Thanks, Sister
Judy. Bye-bye.